Shana Tova, friends. This past year has been very traumatic for all of us. More than 625,000 Americans are dead from COVID-19, and millions infected with the virus, and many with continuing long-term effects. And more than 4.75 million people have died worldwide of the coronavirus. Each person, someone's sibling, parent, spouse, child, each person a world unto themselves. Imagine for a moment how long it would take to read each and every name. You see, it takes on average 3 hours to read the names of all the victims of 9/11 each year. That's approximately 1,000 names an hour. And of course, we will observe the 20th anniversary of 9/11 in just a few days, and we will hear the bell toll, and we will read the names again. But if we were to read all the names of just the American victims of COVID-19, it would take us 434 days nonstop for 24 hours a day, which is 1 year and 78 days, more than 14 months nonstop to recite all the names. And that's just the American victims that we know about so far. The enormity of all this is frankly very hard to comprehend. But even with all of it as a backdrop, as we begin the new year together, I am still heartened by the deep connections that we made in this community during the past years. I'm hopeful, actually, as we begin fresh and new for 5782. We've learned so much in these last 19 months that we now carry with us into the new year. Our Kol Ami community found ways to strengthen each other, sustain each other, deepen our ties with one another, even as we kept ourselves socially distanced. We lived out our motto, Kol Ami Stronger Together. And now we have tried to emerge from our lockdowns and quarantines into a brave new world of vaccines and variants and masks. And though it can be frustrating and sometimes maddening to have to turn on a dime, if you will, we have learned how to adapt. My friends, this is being resilient, being able to learn how to handle situations as they arise. The challenge for all of us is to do so with grace, with humor, and with optimism about the future. All of the studies show that resilience is not about your IQ, how smart you are. Rather, it's only when you are faced with obstacles, stress, and other kinds of threats that you can see whether resilience will be there or the lack of it will happen. We can give in to these traumatic events that we experience, or we can overcome them, demonstrating the very ideal of resilient responses to living. And many of you have done just that. Maria Kornikova wrote about resilience recently in the New Yorker. Decades of research have shown a lot about how resilience actually works. This research shows that resilience is actually and ultimately a set of skills that can be taught. In 1989, a developmental psychologist named Emmy Werner published the results of her 32-year longitudinal project. She'd follow a group of nearly 700 children in Hawaii from before birth through their third decade of life. She monitored them for any exposures to stress, from even from the time they were in utero to growing up. Two-thirds of the children came from backgrounds that were essentially stable, successful, and happy. The other third qualified as at risk. She soon discovered that not all of the at-risk children reacted to stress the same way. Two-thirds of them developed serious learning or behavior problems by the age of 10, or had delinquency records, mental health problems, teenage pregnancies by the age of 18. But the remaining third developed into competent and confident caring young adults. What was it that set the resilient children apart? Werner found that several elements predicted resilience. Some had to do with luck. A resilient child might have a supportive bond with a parent, a caregiver, a teacher, or other mentor-like figure. But another, Werner wrote, quite large set of elements was psychological and had to do with how the children responded to their environment. From a young age, resilient children tended to meet the world on their own terms, as she says. They were autonomous and independent. They would seek out new experiences. Though not especially gifted, these children used whatever skills they had effectively. Perhaps most importantly, the resilient children had what psychologists call internal locus of control. That's fancy words for that the children believed that they and not their circumstances affected their achievements. The resilient children saw themselves as the orchestrators of their own fates. In other words, they had the power of choice, the choice of how to respond, just as we do. We can respond to traumatic events and situations in utter helplessness, feeling battered by the winds of time and circumstance, or we too can believe that we have the power of choices, that we are not helpless or hopeless. My friends, this is what Judaism teaches at its best. We are taught that we have the power to choose life or death, blessings or curses, that we have free will as human beings. We are taught by our great teacher Maimonides this. He wrote, we each decide whether to make ourselves learned or ignorant, compassionate or cruel, generous or miserly. No one forces us. No one decides for us. No one drags us along one path or another, he said. We are responsible for what we are. Resilience is at the core of being a Jew. Choice is in our hand. Now, there are some additional things that help in becoming a resilient person. In a study published by Michelle Tugade and Barbara Fredrickson, they found that resilient individuals use positive emotions to bounce back from negative experiences. They wrote, resilient individuals have optimistic, zestful, and energetic approaches to life, are curious and open to new experiences, and are characterized by what they call high positive emotionality. In addition, they found that very resilient people proactively cultivate the use of humor, relaxation techniques, and optimistic thinking. Their research is groundbreaking. We can see from this the importance of a positive outlook on life that is bolstered by laughter and play and seeing the half glass full rather than empty. This contributes to the ability to be a resilient person. Interestingly, our New Year observances on Rosh Hashanah reinforce these notions. This season of the year is filled with ancient Jewish wisdom that is now confirmed by scientific research. Why do we stress the sweetness of the year ahead in the season? Dipping apples in honey, or eating honey cake or babka or arugula? In part, it is to help us shape opportunities for positive emotionality. We imagine a sweet year ahead. We taste a sweet year ahead. We put ourselves in a positive and hopeful framework that we can start over. We can wipe the slate clean, we say in our prayers. Why do we make the challah round at the season? To show us that we are not fixed in one point in time, but rather we can turn our lives around, that we can always start over. We sound the shofar as we did this morning to raise up our spirits to seek renewal and tshuvah, repentance, the built-in hope that we can be forgiven and seek wholeness once again, that we deserve a clean, fresh start. The shofar sounds remind us that we celebrate the birth of the world and the rebirth of our humanity. emerging spiritually pure in the new year, from free from drama, trauma, and hurts that were done to us and perhaps that we inflicted upon others. Judaism is a religion, a way of being in the world that is built to teach each one of us how to be resilient. And the new year, Rosh Hashanah, is here to help you reframe, rebuild, and renew your resilience skills. We Jews are an ancient people who have experienced some of the worst collective traumas imaginable, from slavery in Egypt to the destruction of our ancient temples and having to reinvent our entire spiritual lives, from the trauma of the Crusaders, the Inquisitions, and expulsions, persecutions fueled by anti-Semitism that continue to this day, and of course, the Shoah, the genocide that is in even greater numbers that have perished from coronavirus so far. Yet, our people have gone on to thrive and live despite attempts to wipe us away. Trauma experts teach us that trauma is not just held psychologically and emotionally, but somatically as well. It's in our bodies, it's in our brains, it's in our limbs. And to release the traumas that we have lived through, we have to do so emotionally, but also we have to do so physically. It's not only enough to talk them through. That is why the use of our Jewish traditions of swaying during prayer, in wrapping yourself in a tallit, of dancing the horah, of chanting the Torah, or the repetitive motions that we use when we draw in the light of the Shabbat and festival candles, is so very important. These aren't mere customs, but they can be part of the healing physical actions necessary from the collective traumas that we've experienced. Whether it's the act of lighting Shabbat and holiday candles, of hearing the sound of the shofar as we did today, or better yet, sounding the shofar. Coming up, we'll be dwelling in the sukkah, of waving the lulav and etrog. It's not some antiquated religious theater, but these ritual movements and choreography can be used to help us overcome the trauma that we hold in our bodies. And so when we double down and use the Jewish traditions that are our treasure and our inheritance, and we practice them, it not only can help us relieve a bit of those traumas, but it can bring meaning and contentment and connection. It can bring healing. It can help us learn how to be more resilient as well. I believe our Jewish tradition and customs, our music, our rituals, help us build that resilience. They do so because as a people, we have known and lived and passed on so much trauma epigenetically from generation to generation. Rituals like going to the mikveh is perhaps our most ancient trauma healing ritual that we spiritually cleanse ourselves in the actual waters of the mikveh. But each time we read from the Torah, from the Tanakh, our Bible, those stories also help us to do so. As Rabbi Erica Ash, who is the president-elect of the Central Conference of American Rabbis, recently wrote, our Jewish story connects us to our ancestors and gives us the tools to build our own resilience in the face of difficulties. We can turn to the texts of the Torah and of the Bible for stories of resilience and inspiration, and specifically, the Torah portions for Rosh Hashanah can help us. Later this morning, we will read from Genesis 21, a complex family story of our patriarch Abraham, his wife Sarah and Hagar, and their children Ishmael and Isaac. At first glance, this is a story of jealousy, of family struggle and strife, of resentments and rivalries. But when we delve deeper, we see it as a story of trauma and finally of resilience. Abraham and Sarah, as you know, could not conceive. And so Abraham had Hagar, Sarah's handmaid, as a surrogate mother. She gives birth to Ishmael, the firstborn of Abraham. The Torah tells us that Hagar had Ishmael on the lap of Sarah, showing that Sarah became the adoptive mother. But in our Torah portion that we will read later this morning, Sarah finally gives birth to her own birth child, Isaac, a biological child of their old age. Abraham was 100, our rabbis teach us, and Sarah in her 90s. Let's talk about a grand miracle. And the Torah relates an incident that happened between Isaac and his older brother Ishmael at the feast of Isaac's weaning. We'll read this morning, and it says, the child, meaning Isaac, grew and was weaned. And on the day Isaac was weaned, Abraham held a great feast. But Sarah saw that the son whom Hagar, the Egyptian, had born to Abraham was Litzachek. And she said to Abraham, get rid of that slave woman and her son, for that woman's son will never share in the inheritance with my son, Isaac. I've used the word Litzachek, the Hebrew word, because it has many meanings. It's first a play on the name of Yitzchak, Isaac, whose name means laughter. Because when Sarah heard she was going to get pregnant after menopause, she laughed at the angel's prophecy. And she then later says, when Isaac's born, that God brought her laughter. But there is a darker side to this word, because it can also mean mocking. That older brother Ishmael, who is now a young teenager in our scene, was mocking the toddler Isaac. Though they seem to be playing together, there is murder in the wind, writes Torah scholar Aviva Zornberg. Sarah sees in her son and Ishmael a replaying of the Cain and Abel story earlier in Genesis, where the older brother Cain eventually murders his brother Abel. Zornberg hints, based upon rabbinic interpretation, that Sarah can see the rivalry and violence that may yet come. Rashi, our great commentator, cites a midrash, a rabbinic tale, that the boys are playing a kind of William Tell game, with Ishmael shooting arrows at Isaac and then claiming, but I'm only playing. And yet, there is another interpretation of this verse, particularly this word litzachek. It means to sport with, play with, and it has sexual overtones. Did Sarah see the older brother abusing the younger brother? Our commentators agree that this is the correct interpretation of the word, bringing proof from many different places. Isaac, either shot at by his older brother, perhaps molested by his older brother, is a victim in this story. And tomorrow morning's Torah portion, Genesis 22, we will willingly see him accompany his father Abraham to the top of Mount Moriah, and his father will bind him to the altar and nearly sacrifice him, stopped only by an angel of God who cries out, Abraham, Abraham, at the last minute staying his hand. Let's take Isaac's perspective for a moment. Can we even imagine what Isaac felt like and saw through his eyes with his father poised over him with a knife? First, his older brother tried to either shoot him or molest him, and then his father tries to kill him. And yet, in the character of Isaac in our Torah, we see an inner strength that has allowed him to thrive. He had a choice. He could have left the story completely and been written out by our ancestors. He could have rejected the traditions of our people. He had a choice to fall apart. Instead, he chose to live his life fully, to stay connected with his family, particularly his mother, Sarah, to fall in love and marry Rebecca, to have two sons whom he loves, to pass on the traditions, the ancient traditions, to the next generation. Isaac chooses wholeness and healing, and is even credited in our tradition with inventing the afternoon mincha prayers as he went out to the fields to meditate reflect, and I like to think, perhaps heal. Now, Isaac is seen by some scholars in Judaism as the weakest of our three patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. One writes that Isaac is but a bridge between the Abraham stories and the Jacob stories, because there are the fewest stories in the Torah about Isaac. And the scholar writes, he seems the meekest of the three. Some interpretation that. I think it's a misreading of who Isaac is. I see Isaac as strong and resilient. He seems to, in some ways, have overcome terrifying relationships with his brother Ishmael and with his father. And he even meets up once again with his brother when the time comes to bury their father. Isaac fulfills his obligation, but let's be honest, they don't hang out much together. Instead, Isaac builds for himself a life, a family. He doesn't dwell in these toxic relationships either. These are beautiful and holy moments and speak to his inner fortitude and his ability to move forward in his life. You see, Isaac chooses life, his life. He has chosen to overcome the many vicissitudes that happened to him. I think Isaac is the embodiment of resilience. As we read these Torah stories, let us see the Isaac in us this year. Let us learn to walk in the fields with hope and prayer and use his example in overcoming life's difficulties, traumas, and terrors to nevertheless build a life of meaning and love. Let us use Jewish tradition, our rituals, to help us rise and to help us overcome the traumas of happened to us, to rebuild our lives and our faith. Let us therefore choose life, choose hope, choose to be among the resilient ones. Let us use these holy days of Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur coming, these 10 days of repentance ahead, to bolster our resilience skills, using the traditions of our people to transform, renew, and refresh our souls. Let us repair ourselves, and in so doing, repair the world. Ken Yehi Ratzon, so may it be God's will.